somebody have a continuation of what we had this morning. Let me say this. Each service that we have is going to be determined by what we make of it. We are the body of believers. We make up the service. It is our anticipation, our faith, our prayer. It is us, whether or not we're hungry or thirsty. Brother Chuck looked at me and said, keep it short tonight. I'm tired. Only joking, of course. He's always doing it. He hides my notes. He does everything in the world to me over there on that front seat. He's guilty. And I got a gift from Sister Smothers' mother, who made me something wonderful. Chuck's over there trying to show it that he's going to eat it while I'm in service. And I'll keep an eye on that. I'll throw my Bible at him if he ain't careful and knock him out in the name of Jesus. Amen? Praise the Lord. And, you know, it is true that God gives us divine moments that we cannot mechanically, with ingenuity, bring it about. It has to be something that God does and inspires and that God leads us into. But regardless, if God comes down and gives us one of those gully washers like he did this morning and opens up the windows of heaven, and it's just evident that divine presence is here to do something special, you can get something special out of every service. If you'll concentrate, if you'll set your mind, if you'll set your heart, if you'll fix your attention upon the word of the Lord, the word of the Lord will speak to you every time you come into the house of the Lord. The Lord will do something in your life. Tonight I want to preach to you some material that I have used before, or at least some of it, and, you know, switch it up, because the Lord laid it in my spirit. It's been in my spirit for some time, and tonight I just couldn't get away from it. I just kept putting it on the back burner, kept putting it on the back burner, kept putting it on the back burner, and finally the Lord just kind of this week had laid it in my spirit, and I just want to talk to you a little bit about Matthew chapter 11, starting with verse 22, if you have your Bibles. Matthew chapter 11, starting with verse 22, if you'd stand for the reading of the word. Thank the Lord for our youth group tonight who led us in worship. It's different than what we're used to, but they've done a wonderful job. Amen. They're different. Brother Rex has took him a little mini vacation. He's had a rough year. His dad has passed away, and different things have been going on. He's been afflicted as well, and it's not been something that's been broadcasted as much, but pray for him bodily. He's been going through some things, and just needed to get away with Shirley, and we just pray that the Lord will refresh him and bless him, heal him, and minister to him. It's hard to lose a loved one in death, and we want to pray that God would just give him a time of relaxation, a time of a regeneration, a renewal in his spirit, and he'll be able to come back refreshed in the Lord. In Mark chapter 11, starting with verse 22, the Bible says, "And Jesus answered and said unto them, Have faith in God. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, Be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe the things which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Therefore I say unto you, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that ye receive them, and ye shall have them. And when ye stand praying, forgive, if you have aught against any, that your Father also which is in heaven may forgive you of your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your heavenly Father, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive you of your trespasses." I'm going to ask tonight, Brother Sales, would you ask the Lord's blessing on the word of the Lord, please? Amen. We're going to dive into this thing just a little bit tonight, and I want you to notice between verse 23 and verse 24, there is a shift in the focus of Jesus' teaching. If you look at verse 23, there is a certain outline for prayer, and then when you look in verse 24, there's a different outline for prayer. And it's not that Jesus is teaching you something opposite. It's just telling you there are two principles of prayer that you and I are going to have to learn in this journey of life in order to have the victory that you and I desire. Isn't it odd that you see sometimes people more gifted, it seems like, in certain areas than others when it comes to this thing called prayer, and when it comes to this thing called the working of miracles or the working of healing or the gift of healing or the gift of faith? There are times you can look over and you see these things more prominent in certain lives than you do other people's lives. And yet when you begin to uncover this thing, you're going to understand that Jesus is teaching us two different kinds of praying, two different techniques of prayer, two different types, what we should call a prayer. And these two types of prayer go hand in hand in order to bring about to meet the total makeup of man. And we're going to talk about that. We are really familiar with one of those types of prayers, but there's one of the prayers that I'm afraid that we Pentecostals, even though we don't know it, we do not exercise it enough in our lives, and therefore we do not have the fruit or the reward of what kind of results that prayer brings about. You and I got to understand that we have to stay in biblical principle, and we have to stay in biblical patterns, and we have to appropriate the Word of God in order to be able to see the manifestation of God's glory, because God works in the outline of Scripture. How many believes that? How many believes that God's got it laid out for us, and if we'll follow it to a letter, that God will bless us, that God will prosper us? Now, I don't want to spend a lot of time, but I want to talk to you a little bit about moving mountains, because if God knows, it's nothing new that there's always been mountains that we've had to face. All throughout generations, there's been mountains that people have had to climb, and there's been mountains that people have had to overcome, and there's been mountains of difficulty, mountains of darkness, mountains of affliction, mountains, and you can go on and on and on. But I believe that there are more mountains and more giants in the land now than there's ever been. I believe that we're facing something horrendous in these last days. I am making a prediction, and you'll hear me preach about it probably Sunday morning, unless the Lord changes my mind. I've been saying that here lately, because every time I think I got this thing figured out, God changes my mind. He changed my mind this morning, and or for this morning's message. He changed it last night. But nevertheless, God's able to do those kinds of things. I believe that we are beginning to see things in America that we haven't seen in years and years and years, but it's been relevantly seen in third world countries for years and years and years. Some of the things that I think that you and I are going to see is an explosion of manifestation of demonic spirits. I believe that because of America has let down her hedge, and we're going to talk about that Easter, I believe, if the Lord will allow me to preach it that way. We're going to be talking about deliverance and the deliverance through the cross and what the resurrection and the ascension of Jesus Christ really means. And I want to tell you, if Jesus Christ is not risen from the dead, we're yet dead in our sins. Thanks be unto God that He's alive forevermore, and He sits at the right hand of the Father to make intercessory for us. But the first thing that I want to talk to you in this thing called moving mountains, the first thing that we got to do is prepare ourselves spiritually to approach the throne of God. We have to be prepared spiritually. There is a thing called preparation. There's a thing called walking in holiness. There's a thing called walking in the Spirit so we won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. There is still a thing called holiness unto the Lord. How many believe that? As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us in Psalm 66 and 18 that if we regard iniquity in our heart, the Lord will not hear us. The Bible tells us in John 9 and 31. Now we know that God heareth not sinners, but there's two things that He says. But we know that if any man be a worshiper of God and doeth His will, him He heareth. He said one of the prerequests of God answering prayer is that we're worshipers, that you and I have to learn to worship Him. How many believe that God answers prayer when we worship Him? And not only do we worship Him, but we do His will. We have to do the will of the Father. We have to be obedient children. This disobedient stuff is killing the church of the living God. People think they can play cat and mouse with the enemy and not get burnt, but let me tell you, it's affecting us spiritually when men and women are not obedient unto the faith and obedient to Scripture. Can I have an amen? God help me preach right there just a little bit. But the Scripture also tells us in James 5 and 16 to confess your faults one to another and pray one for another that what? You may be healed. For the effectual fervent prayer of what? A righteous man availeth much. The Bible tells us that it's a righteous man's prayer that's effectual and fervent, that's hot, that's going to get the results that we desire. The Bible tells us in Psalms 33 verse 15 or 34 15 says the eyes of the Lord are upon the righteous and His ears are extended under their cry. die. The Bible tells us in John chapter 15, verse 7, Jesus said, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, then you shall ask what you will and it shall be given to you. In 2 Chronicles 7, 14, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and what? Turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven, I will forgive their sins, and I will heal their land. Now, it's not how many times that we pray to God. It's whether or not that we are prepared spiritually to approach the throne of God, and it's according to how much you and I believe when we get there of whether or not that you and I are going to have results. Repetitious prayer is not necessarily meaning that we're going to have the answers to the prayers that we've been praying. It's whether or not we're prepared spiritually, and it's whether or not that we have faith when we arrive before God, because God does nothing outside of honoring faith. Can I have an amen? You see, Mark chapter 11, verse 25 and 26, he goes on in that passage of scripture in our text a little bit lower, and he tells us, and when you stand praying, forgive if you have aught against any, that your Father which is in heaven will forgive you of your trespasses. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive you of your trespasses. Here he's telling us that if I am going to have prayers answered, then I have to have a clean slate with my fellow man. I cannot have a grudge against Bill and God answer my prayer. I can't hold a grudge against somebody in this building and God answer my prayers. The Bible tells us that if I have aught against a brother, or if I feel like a brother's got aught against me, I'm to go to him. I am to leave my gift at the altar and go to him and make it right. And if I don't make it right, if I think somebody's got aught against me, I'm to go to him. I personally do not know of anybody right now that has an aught against me that I'm personally aware of. There's probably many. But I want to tell you something. The Bible tells us that if we hold grudge, that if we're unforgiving, that if you and I sit around and we have frictions between one another, that God the Father will not hear us when we pray. And we cannot afford to have unanswered prayers. There's mountains to be removed. There's obstacles to overcome. There's giants to kill. And you and I are going to have to pay attention of how that we are to build our lives up to the point that we can face these giants with confidence and bring them down and be a giant slayer like that of David. But notice that willful sin that is not repented of, that we try to hide from God and even hide from others, and most of the time we even hide it for ourselves, that willful sin that's inside of us that we will not repent of, it closes the avenues of approach to the very throne of Almighty God. Sin separates. Can I have an amen? That is a biblical principle that you and I have to understand. Sin separates, but thanks be unto God, through the confession of sin, through the blood of Jesus, we have access to the very throne room of God himself. The Bible tells us in the book of Ephesians 2 and 13, you who sometimes were afore off, you're made nigh, or you're brought near to God through the blood of Jesus Christ, his son. The writer of Hebrews says, we have a high priest who's passed into the heavens, Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering. And then he goes on and tells us, for we can approach the throne of God boldly, that you and I might receive help and mercy in our time of need. Jesus has made a way possible to the very throne room. He's opened the avenues of approach to God through his death upon the cross. And all of us who have had the shed blood on our lives and are living holy before him have the access to the very throne of God with Jesus being our interceder, pleading our case before the Lord. Give the Lord praise for that. But sin closes the avenues of approach to the throne of God. Our text says, have faith in Mark 11, 22, have faith in God. Now, those three words don't sound like very much, but when you really begin to study it out, it's impossible to have faith without being faithful. Did you know faith and faithfulness cannot be separated, because faith produces faithfulness? When a man says faith and he's not faithful, he's a liar. Come on, somebody help me preach. Faith produces faithfulness. You believe in something, you're going to act it out. Can I have an amen? A belief is what regulates our lives. I've said it a lot of times to this congregation, and that is that we don't have a behavior problem, we have a belief problem, because whatever we believe is what we actually live out in behavior. Can I have an amen? If we truly believe that the Lord truly looks down upon us and sees everything that we do, and we truly believe he is a rewarder of them that diligently do good, that he will withhold no good thing to them that walk uprightly, and if we truly believe that we can ask him of anything that we desire and we will have it, then I believe our behavior pattern would be different. Can I have an amen? God has promised divine provision for his body. But notice this, that you show me a man with faith, and I'll show you a man that is faithful. And a lack of faithfulness, what does it do? It brings condemnation and guilt, and the end result is it's a lie possessed with doubt. This morning, as we had that wonderful service and many people committed their lives to Christ, there was some here that I talked to personally that was backslidden for a long time, and I could tell, and the Lord led me on two different occasions to talk to a few individuals, and one of the things the Lord was telling me to tell them was, quit wallowing around in condemnation and guilt because of the past, that he's a God that does forgive. Praise the name of the Lord for that. But I want to tell you something. When you sin, that guilt gets so strong that if we're not careful, guilt and condemnation will destroy a man. Can I have an amen? When we're disobedient, that guilt and that condemnation is one of the biggest giants that you and I have to overcome. But in order to remove the mountains in our lives, we must have our faith built up to the level of the mountain that we're trying to remove. Because all mountains are not the same size. Did you know that? The Bible even tells us that Jesus said these words. He said that some only come out by prayer and fasting. Can I have an amen? All mountains are not the same size. Some are bigger than others, and some are larger than others. And you and I are going to have our faith built up to the level of the mountain that we're trying to remove. And I'm here to tell you that we do not have, though, as a body of believers, to put up with defeat in areas that we think there is no deliverance and believe that it's just a part of our lives, because all things can be conquered in Jesus Christ, and we are made more than conquerors, and we are overcomers by the blood of Jesus Christ and by the word of our testimony. Look at somebody and say, you are an overcomer. Amen. But if we're going to overcome, it must be overcome by faith. Hebrews 11 and 6 says, but without faith it's impossible to please God. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is. These are rewarder of them that diligently seek him. You know, I told a story years ago, and I don't know how many of you remembered it, but I don't know if it's a true story or not, but I heard of a young preacher that was trying. He came to a church, and the church was really growing pretty well, and there was an older lady there that had tried to get her husband into church for years, and she kept coming by and inviting the preacher over for dinner, and inviting the preacher over for this, inviting the preacher over for that, and every time she turned around, the preacher was getting a call from her, can you go see John, can you go to so-and-so with John, and when it come down to it, her husband John was unsaved, and she wanted this preacher somehow to get him saved. So he started, you know, understanding why the little lady was there. And after building a relationship with this man began to talk to him and said, why is it you preachers are all alike? He said, I don't understand. What do you mean? He said, if you could show me one thing in Scripture that I could believe without having to believe it by faith, you always lay everything off on this faith thing. Faith that you can't see. You know, you just have to believe even though you can't see it. Said, if you can show me one thing in Scripture that is true without a shadow of a doubt, without me having to accept it by faith, if you can prove it, I will believe the whole Bible. And so the young preacher easily said, okay, and he just jumped on the man, grabbed a hold of his nose and started wringing it and twisting it and turning it, and the man's screaming and he's hollering, and what in the world's gone wrong with you? And he pulled off and his nose was bleeding, and he said, the man was upset, and he said, well, you told me that if I could show you one thing in Scripture that was evident without you having to believe it by faith, and you could see it with your own eyes, that you would believe the whole thing. He said, yeah, but what's this got to do anything with it? And the man quoted Proverbs 30:33. Surely the churning of milk bringeth forth butter, and the wringing of the nose bringeth forth blood. Amen? Some of you are getting that now. And the truth of the matter is, we as people a lot of times are wanting the proof before we see it. We're wanting the proof before we're able to believe it. But the problem of it is, we got to believe it before we get the proof or the evidence of it. And that only comes by having faith in God. Having faith in God. Can I have an amen? The Bible tells us in Habakkuk 2:4, the just shall live by faith. Romans 1:17, the just shall live by faith. Galatians 3:11, the just shall live by faith. Hebrews 10:38, the just shall live by faith. Paul said, the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. The Bible tells us that faith is not by sight. It's by feeling. It's not by emotion, but it's by believing faith. And Jesus even said in Matthew 7:20-21 to his disciples, when a man had a son that was of a lunatic, and every time he walked by the water, the demon inside of him would launch him in the water and try to drown him. Every time he walked by the fire, this boy would try to get in the fire and it would try to burn him and destroy him. He took him to his disciples. His disciples could not cast out the demon. And the man came to him and tells Jesus the scenario. And Jesus rebukes the foul spirit, casts the demon out. The young man is clothed in his right mind and he's completely free. The disciples said, why couldn't we do this? And Jesus said unto them, because of your unbelief. For I say unto you, if you have faith as the grain of a mustard seed, you shall say unto this mountain, remove to yonder place, and it shall be removed, and nothing shall be impossible unto you. Howbeit, this kind goeth out by prayer and by fasting. In other words, Jesus says, you were not prepared to meet the need or to cast the mountain out. That mountain was too bigger than your faith was. And he said, this kind only goes out by much prayer and fasting. What the Bible says in Romans chapter 10, verse 17, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing the word of God. The Bible tells us in Jude verse 20 that building up your most holy faith by praying in the Holy Spirit. We have to have our faith built up. But the next step is in order to overcome these mountains. How many wants to overcome some mountains in your life? Raise your hand. In order to overcome these mountains, there's some things that you got to do. Number one, the next step is that we got to speak directly to the mountain. Now, that's something we don't do in Pentecostals regularly. We think of it sporadically. But we're not going to see any mountains be removed if we don't take the authority that Christ has given us and speak to those mountains. Now, we think of prayer only by petitioning God. And can I tell you that petition prayer is for the things that God gives to man. You don't go around and command God to give you this, that, or the other. God gives us great, precious gifts. I don't go command God to give me the Holy Ghost, the gift of God. I don't go command him to give me salvation. I don't go to command him to give me anything. I ask of him as a heavenly Father and believe that he will. That's what the verse 24 says. Therefore, I say unto you, what things soever you desire when you pray, believe that you shall receive them and you shall have them. This is a petitioning prayer before God. It is saying that if I got a desire and I believe that God will really meet that desire, I shall have them when I pray them. Can I have an amen? That's what it says. Now, I want you to notice that the petitioning prayer is not the prayer that removes mountains. Can I have an amen? The petitioning prayer is the petitioning prayer in order for us to receive freely the things of God that God has given to us freely. Matter of fact, it's found in scriptures like in Matthew chapter 7, verse 7 and 8. Ask and you shall receive. Seek, ye shall find. Knock, and it shall be opened to you. For everyone that asketh, receiveth. To him that seeketh, findeth. To him that knocketh, it shall be opened unto him. It is found in 1 John 5:14-15. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he heareth us. And if we know that he hears us, whatsoever we ask, then we know that we have the petitions that we desire of him. The Bible tells us in James that we have not because we ask not. Petition prayer is not the prayer that moves mountains. It is the prayer of preparation. It is the prayer that changes us. It's the prayer that empowers us. It is the prayer that keeps the avenues of approach to the throne of God open before the Lord. Can I have an amen? But the mountain moving prayer is the commanding prayer. Some of us is asking God to remove things in our lives that he's already given us the ability and the power to remove them ourselves. Hello? God wants us to understand that the mountain moving prayer is the commanding prayer. We are to speak directly to the mountain of opposition. that thing that is of a spiritual force that stands up to try to buffet us and hinder us. God has told the body to take the rightful place as a child of God, as a son of God, and with the authority of Jesus Christ, stand up and rebuke that thing and speak unto that mountain, be thou removed, and believe in our heart, and it shall be done. That's what the Bible tells us. Look at our text in verse 23. For verily I say unto you that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed and cast into the sea, and not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that the things in which he saith shall come to pass, he shall have whatsoever he saith. Where does it say to ask anywhere in that particular prayer? It doesn't. We are to take the authority of Christ that he's already given us, step out on faith, and believe the word of God, and command the mountains to be removed. Caution. Before we command the mountains to be removed, we got to make sure that step one's taken care of first. Because we see something in the book of Acts, in Acts chapter 19, there was some vagabond Jews trying to remove mountains, but were not prepared spiritually to approach the throne of God, and we've seen something very harshly happen to them. They were known as the seven sons of Scythia. Paul had been casting out demons, and Paul would go up to people that were demon-possessed and said, I say in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I adjure you, demons, to come out of this man. And their men would be set free under the laying on of the hands of the Apostle Paul. And the seven sons of Scythia seen that, and they thought, wow, let's try that. And they went over to a demon-possessed man. The seven men laid their hands on him and say, they said, in the name of Jesus Christ, whom Paul preaches, we command you to come out of them. And the Bible says, yes, and evil spirits leaped upon them and prevailed against them, and they ran out of the house wounded and naked. They done that because of the problem is they did not have relationship with God. They did not carry the anointing. They did not have the power of the Spirit behind them because they were not prepared spiritually to remove mountains in their lives. Can I have an amen? So we have to have, number one, we have to have our spiritual lives intact. First of all, we have to have step one taken care of. We have to be prepared. Number two, we have to have faith in God. But then we have to speak unto the mountain. Did you know every day in your life the mountain speaks to you? It ridicules you. It accuses you. It mocks you. And it makes you. It makes fun of you. And it tries to challenge you. And every mountain in your life that begins to bring a challenge to you like that is of the evil spirit, of the evil domain, the enemy's coming against to try to buffet you. Mountains are from spirits of demons and devils and darkness, and some may even be nature running their courses. But listen to me. The longer we let the mountain stay in our lives, the longer that you and I are defeated. And the longer the mountain stays there, the bigger that mountain becomes, and it will hinder you, overtake you, and buffet you, and the end result is it will control you. I remember one time Brother White telling us a story that happened down in the region of where he was from. It was down in the Crothersville area in one of those churches. It wasn't in Crothersville. That's where Brother White was from, but it was on that district. There was a church. I can't remember if it was Tyler or Braggadocia years ago. There's a group of ladies that was having a prayer meeting on Tuesday nights or Tuesday mornings, or was it Tuesday mornings? I believe it was. And one day of the week, they were gathered together. They were all praying, and they began to pray, and all of a sudden, in the middle of the sanctuary, fear hit that place, and they heard something growl at them, like that, an audible voice. Every single one of the women heard it. All of the women get up, and they jump up, and they take off running, and they're afraid, and they get outside of the church, and their hearts are pounding, and they're saying, surely there was an evil spirit that came against our prayer meeting today. And they were all afraid and said, what are we going to do? What are we going to do? The pastor's out of town. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? And one of the old ladies said, we're going to go down to Grandma, I think it was either Grandma Blue or Grandma Green. I know it was a color. And they went down there, and she's 90 years old, and they go into the house, and they start telling this story to Grandma Green. And Grandma Green just stands up, says, hand me my cane, and they give her cane, and she always wore a shawl over her head, they said. And in the middle of the summer, she had long sleeve shirts on, a long dress, and had big, thick holes, and they said she had glasses about like telescopes. They were old. She was 90-some years old. Said she puts on her little shawl, and she lives right down the road, and she's walking. It takes forever to get to the church. Where are you going? She said, we're going to go pray. We're not going to let no devil run y'all out of no prayer meeting. And she went down there, a 90-some-year-old woman, and she walks in, and she can't kneel, but she goes up to the front, and she just starts petitioning God. She told the ladies, petition God, start praying to the Lord. And though, Lord, bless our church, oh, Lord, send revival. And all of a sudden that thing, like that again. And old Grandma Green, they said, yeah, I hear you, you devil. And in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, you have no place in the sanctuary of God. And I command you, you evil spirit and you foe, to get out of here. And they said, literally, the back doors went, as that thing left that building. Now you say, I don't believe in all of that nonsense. You better believe it, because it's real. And there's power in the name of Jesus. There's authority in the name of Jesus. There's dominion in the name of Jesus. And some of us are not appropriating the name of Jesus Christ, and we're putting up with mountains in our lives. Can I have an amen? Speak to that mountain. Be thou removed and cast into the sea. You're not doubting our heart. This is why that Jesus said in John 16 in his teaching, he said, these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name they shall cast out devils. They shall speak with new tongues. They shall take up serpents. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. You know what the Bible literally tells us there? Nowhere do we petition here in this scripture for God to do those things for us. It is literally, actually, us taking the name of Jesus Christ and speaking it. In my name, they shall. In my name, use his name. That's what he's saying. I've given you the authority to lay hands on the sick. I've given you the authority to speak to the mountain of affliction. I've given you the authority to speak deliverance over people. I've given you the authority. We sit around saying, well, what if it don't happen? Then we're doubting in our heart. Amen. God's ready to turn this place inside and out, but it's going to take believers looking at mountains and speaking to those mountains, and when those mountains speak back, you just keep on talking. Why is it in the natural? Me and my wife every once in a while gets in what we call discussions. Do y'all have any of those discussions around your house? I'm just human enough and honest enough to tell you we have discussions. Long, lengthy discussions sometimes. Not very often, but, you know, believe it or not, me and that little lady have differences from time to time. You know, it's hard to believe she's wrong, but, you know, it happens. Yeah, she's not here. You're right, baby. I get by with it tonight. Well, no, I won't, because I'll have to buy five of my brother's supper so that she won't get told about it. That's how they treat me. If you don't buy my lunch, I'll tell Jenny what you said behind that pulpit. Lord, have mercy. But there are times we have discussions. And in those human discussions, when you get frustrated and irritated, come on, anybody know what I'm talking about? You don't shut up just because someone disagrees with you. You know what it does? It stirs you up. And you know what it does? It provokes you. Somebody help me preach. I think you know where I'm headed with this thing. Sometimes me and Jenny's discussions can happen 20 minutes to an hour at a time. Hello? They used to happen more frequently than they do now. I've changed her over the years. Hello? I'm digging myself in a early grave. I can feel it coming on. But the truth of the matter is, you and I both know that there's times of disagreements with people of flesh to where you can get bullheaded and stubborn. You know what Jenny's told me in the past? You're just a stubborn miller. Because we are stubborn people. We get our minds fixed. Man, you just can't hardly change it. And there's been times in our past that we sit back and forth. Blah, 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 blah. She'd say something, I'd counteract it. And then she'd counteract me. Then I'd counteract her. And it was really, if you're not careful, they can turn into wars. It turns into the man usually sleeping on the couch and the woman getting the bed. That's not right. Amen? But it brings a battle. But in the spirit realm, us Christians, we'll pray for somebody and we'll speak to that mountain. And because it don't happen, and the mountain says, see, it didn't happen, we back down just like that. We have no persistence. We have no endurance. Come on. Somehow, the first time that thing says boo, we feel like we're defeated. Where is the backbone of the church? And it's when it says, I'm still here. Yes, sir, you may be, but you won't be there long. Can't just keep bombarding that. Just because the mountain that you speak to is not gone overnight does not mean that it cannot be gone. Keep speaking, keep talking, keep commanding, keep pursuing, and keep on keeping on and keep on keeping on day by day. That is a stronghold. That thing wasn't built overnight. Some of them don't leave overnight. It takes the audacity of somebody to stand up under the anointing and the faith of God and declare the works of God and stay there until it's done. Hallelujah. Just day after day, if it takes days, just keep speaking. Just keep speaking. Just keep speaking. We used to sing an old song in Ninth and Cedar. We have the power in the name of Jesus. We have the power in the name of the Lord. Though Satan rages, we will not be defeated. Am I singing all right? We have the power in the name of the Lord. Amen? You got the power. Our problem is the first time that don't go away, we recheck ourselves. Well, I must have something wrong, or this formula don't work like the preacher says it works. It does work. It works. And we're going to start doing it. We're going to start believing God. In closing, me and Chuck Lambert years ago was talking, and we was talking about this very thing back. I've got it marked in my Bible there, or in my footnotes there. Me and him had a discussion, and I wrote a story down that I put Chuck Lambert in the date, 1993, almost 20 years ago. And we were talking about these scriptures. 1993, I preached a series on this about speaking on the mountain, having the authority, and where the authority comes from. Chuck heard a documentary overseas. There was a tribe. Some missionaries went there. And was trying to, was winning the tribe to the Lord. They were starving to death. They were poor. They were in poverty. After getting the village saved, the whole village gets saved. The missionaries then begin to clear trees and begin to clear the bottom land in the mountains to grow crops, to show them how to plant, to show them how to better themselves, how to live. These people are starving to death. Started planting, but the plants wouldn't grow. And the reason why is because where that little village was at, it was setting right down in the middle of big, tall mountains. And the sun would just kind of circle and had very little sunlight because of trees and the mountains and everything. The crops wouldn't grow. And one night, the preacher got up and preached this message, a similar message to what I preached, you know, about speaking in the mountains, be thou removed. A guy gets up the next morning after hearing that sermon at church that night, and they say that he's out on his little hut, front porch, and he's facing the south. And there's a huge mountain there. And he's saying, mountain, be thou removed in the name of Jesus. And be thou cast into the sea. He'd wait a while and it wouldn't happen. He'd do it again. And he'd do it again. He'd do it again. Finally, some of the missionaries seen what he did. Said, oh, no, brother, you've misunderstood us. So we're talking about spiritual mountains. That's a mountain of difficulty. It won't let us grow crops. He wouldn't listen to the missionaries. He got back down and he started again. In the name of Jesus. Every day he started doing that. A few months later, one morning they heard the awfulest noise. Them people never heard anything like it. And some of the missionaries were still there. A lot of them went home. And they got to listening, and there was dozers running, trees crashing. And there was a big corporation that bought the top of that mountain, and they were leveling it. And they were taking the dirt off of it. They were going to build a huge, big factory there. And to make a long story short, they took that mountain down to the perfect elevation, to where it gave the perfect sunlight to that valley, to where their crops could grow. And the company ended up not even building there. What done it? It was just one old layman that heard the word of the Lord and by faith went out and stared at a mountain every single day and sat there over a period of time every day and would say, "Mountain, be thou removed and cast into the sea." And he just kept on and kept on and kept on till the American corporation, God got a hold of the heart of some corporate leader, and they went over there and tore the top of a mountain off. And from that day forward, that valley grew and they prospered, and that village got the provision that was needed because of a layman that dared believe God that he could remove a physical mountain if necessary. God can remove mountains in your life. I'm telling you, I have seen this principle work over, and sometimes I even forget it. Sometimes we're not reminded of it enough. We preach sermons and we think everybody knows it, and we don't want to go back to old material. Well, they've heard that before, and we're not repetition to what we keep it in the forefront of the church. It's a discipline of prayer. It is a commanding prayer. It is knowing who you are in Christ, knowing who you are in the Lord, and standing up under the authority of the Holy Spirit and speaking directly to a mountain of difficulty in your life. I've been in a lot of churches in my life, and I want to tell you something. Very few churches even know about this kind of praying. I'm telling you the truth. They're down begging and beseeching God to give them something that he gave them the authority over a long, long, long time ago. And God wants us to exercise our faith tonight. Would you stand with me, please? You know what? Tonight I feel like that the Lord wants us to do is just commit ourselves in prayer. And then obey the voice of the Lord. But you know what? I think all of us need to come to that place where we prepare ourselves spiritually. Lord, if there be any sin in my life, if there be any ought in my life, if there's anything that's hindering me in my prayer life, forgive me. And mean it with everything. And then begin to start speaking to your mountain. Mountain in the name of Jesus. Mountain of affliction, call it by name. Cancer in the name of Jesus. Breast cancer, and get specific as you know how, in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus. I invoke the name of Jesus a lot around my house because I believe there's power in that name. I believe demons know that name, and I think they fear and they tremble every time they hear it. The lovely name of Jesus. What a lovely name. As the old song says, there is none other. Oh, what a lovely name, the name of Jesus. And we need to start understanding that there's power in that name. It's odd how that people in America, you're talking about those that are non-believers, you're talking about those that, you know, are even somewhat claiming to be spiritual, but they're involved in cults and everything. They don't have a problem saying the name of God. As a matter of fact, when you get on television, it's always God this, God that, God this, God that. But never do you hear anybody saying the name of Jesus. Because the name of Jesus is what distinguishes all other religions, that distinguishes us apart from all other religions. There's a lot of people that believe in God, but I want to tell you, they won't accept the name of Jesus. And whatever spirit does not accept the name of Jesus is the spirit of Antichrist. Because it is in that lovely name, that name of Jesus, that the church exists and it moves and it has its being. All healing comes through the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. If you would tonight, would you just come forward and ask the Lord to begin to strengthen your faith, give you the courage to war against your mountains, to begin to get the boldness to start speaking to mountains in other people's lives, and when they ask you to pray for them, lay hands on them and say, in the name of Jesus, we rebuke the enemy and we speak into this mountain, be thou removed. I believe that God cares and that God will begin to do great things on our behalf. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. What a lovely name, the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.